Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined by a very special guest. For those that have listened to me ramble on other podcasts, I've said that I started watching wrestling in Scotland anyway in 2012, and there was one show that happened, and we'll get into the nitty gritty of it towards it. But this is a guy that had the moment that had me go, right, I'm paying attention to Scottish wrestling. So no pressure on him. I'm joined by Retro Randy Valentine. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me along, Billy. Really appreciate you inviting me.
I'm so excited. As soon as I saw that Retro Randy Valentine was back, I was on your DMs very quickly afterwards. I was like, no, we're doing this. We've got to get you on this now. But I'm so excited for this because, like I was saying just before we went on air, for those that are on air, like I'm a radio host, I was saying that I was going to Scottish wrestling 10 years ago, and you were one of the reasons why I kept coming back. So I was wanting to get you on sometime this year anyway. So I'm glad that the stars have aligned and we've finally got this going. But the first question is the most cliche, easy question. Lewis Young's even asked it in our Twitter questions here. How did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment that got you hooked on pro wrestling?
The easy question, but it's maybe not the easy answer. And you'll have to forgive me because I'm terrible for rambling.
Okay.
And I'm terrible for going off on tangents. So I'll try and minimize that. I'll try and stay on point. But as a fan, I got involved. I became a fan, probably like most people in the UK. When we got Sky, I'd seen wrestling on Saturday afternoons, World of Sport. It was, it was on before the football results and things. So, I'd seen wrestling. I was kind of aware of wrestling, but wasn't really a fan of wrestling. And my father, he kind of introduced me to it, spotted that wrestling was on. I said, oh, I need to watch this, thinking I liked comics and cartoons and all these kind of things. So love wrestling, and the first match that I remember that sticks with me was Rugged Ronnie Garvin against Mr. Perfect, and I could not stop laughing at the name Mr. Perfect. I just thought it was the biggest load of nonsense. It was absolutely ridiculous. It was just, I was not instantly hooked. My dad took a little bit of encouragement from him. No, keep watching it. You'll like it. And yeah, the more I watched it, the more I saw the characters. The Ultimate Warrior was the first, that was the first guy that was like, whoa, all this energy and assholes and face paint. And yeah, so pretty quickly became a fan. And that was it, stuck with it, that from then on, from sort of WrestleMania 6 time. WrestleMania 6 is the first big show that I kind of remember watching, sort of sitting and watch what I thought was watching live. I don't think it was live at that time on Sky Movies, of all things. It wasn't on Sky Sports, Sky Movies that had it. But yeah, I was hooked, and stayed hooked, to the point that I lived in Arbroath at the time. And there was a live show. There was live wrestling. Now, I'd been to Glasgow, I think, twice by this time, where my dad and reluctantly my uncle going along to see the WWF. Fun little story from that. The main event was Shawn Michaels against... Shawn Michaels against Randy Savage. Randy Savage was space. He was, I think that was when he was champion. I think this was post WrestleMania 8. I feel like Michaels might have been Intercontinental champion. You had Sherry with him at the time, and the crowd are booing, giving Sherry serious heat. Boo, boo, boo. My dad misheard and started shouting out, hur, hur, hur. All these tiny little children. And he's bellowing out, hur. But that was the first time that I'd seen wrestling live, and this was back at a time where these guys were big. I was small, So rushing up to the railings and everything else, getting hand out for the mind was blown at the size. You see them on the telly, see them in person. It's like, so yeah, live wrestling was coming. There was a wrestling show coming to the community centre in Arbroath. And me and my dad, it's like, let's go along and check this out. So it was mid-90s time. It was the period of the tribute shows that you would get in the UK. So it was headlined, the UK Undertaker was on it. I'm trying to think if there were any other. I don't know. I don't think there was a Kane. I don't know if there was a Kane. No. But there was the Legend of Doom, who it turns out was Ricky Knight,
Okay.
the WAW promoter. So yeah, he comes out and is like, he's got all the gear and everything on. And there was a young Scottish guy, blonde hair, can't remember the name. Blonde hair, young guy, had the salt iron on his trunks and everything. Scottish guy, the wrestler is a Scottish wrestler. Now by this time I was like, I'm talking about this like I was a kid. I wasn't a kid. By this time I was 25-ish, there and thereabouts. So I'm like, this is amazing. Hung about at the end to speak to this Scottish wrestler and find out how this Scottish guy became a Scottish wrestler. And out he comes. Oh, I really liked your match. How did you get into it? And out comes this thick Norfolk accent. And he's like, oh no, he says, if we're doing shows in Wales, I'm Welsh. If we're doing shows in Ireland, I'm Irish. If we're doing shows in Scotland, I'm Scottish. I'm not actually Scottish. But he put me in touch with the WAW. He said, if you're serious, if you're wanting to train and become a wrestler, then reach out, get in touch. So I sent this little essay by post, because there was no email and things like that. This was back in the dark ages. Sent the letter away down and waited about a month or so later. I get a letter back on this WAW headed paper. This was like my letter from Vince. This was amazing. This was my, here we go. So I can't remember off the top of my head how much it was. And to be honest, I wouldn't want to say how much. It was expensive to go down. Accommodation and two meals a day were included, and I went down for a fortnight to train. So off I went down to Norwich to train with WAW, which head of the game. Look, I looked out. I don't have much from then, but I do have some photos. So trained down at the Matrix in Norwich with this guy here, Bruce Solomon, who was part of a tag team called the Furies, the Baseball Furies, which was a fantastic gimmick. If you know the movie The Warriors at all, I don't know if you've.
I've never seen it, but I know of it.
It's
I think I
amazing.
know enough to get by.
So there's a gang in that were all baseball uniforms, painted faces, carried baseball bats, wrestling gimmick, all it. To be honest, The Warriors itself is just, if they ever decide to remake it, they just need to remake it with wrestlers because the two go together so well. But yeah. Went down and trained with Roy Knight, and trained with Ricky. Ricky didn't really do anything in the ring. A guy called Billy Ocean was also, he would come along and sort of critique, but it was Bruce that took the majority of the training. And some of it was good, some of it was not. And I don't want to, I don't want to say ill of anyone, and it got my start, but I feel like there was some people that were there training that they paid and kind of look, not that I was anything spectacular myself, but you looked and you thought, these people aren't going to be wrestlers. They're just kind of handing over money to roll around in the ring for a fun. The accommodation was just sleeping on Bruce's couch, and the two meals a day were breakfast. There was a little cafe just next to the Matrix, so you get a full English breakfast, which was great. The evening meal was whatever Bruce would chuck in the microwave. So value for money maybe wasn't quite there because it was quite expensive for this fortnight of training. But yeah, did it. Finished up with that. then did a couple of shows for Ricky, for Paddy down in Norwich for WAW. And then that was about it. It was kind of radio silence for, because that was the April that I'd went down and trained. Didn't really hear anything else until end of June, start of July, and he asked if I wanted to come down and do the sort of the camp circuits with him, which was great. It was hard. It was long days and it was hard days. Start off the day going and picking up the loading up the van, with a ring. We drive through the holiday camp in Hemsby. Can't remember the name of it, but that's where we that was the regular site. So you'd go there, set up the ring, wrestle a match, and then the main event was either a rumble or a 6-man tag. When I say it was a rumble, there was only six of us there. So it was a pretty small rumble. But we did. You did your six. There was three singles matches, and then a whatever, either a 6-man main or a rumble main. And then you tore the ring down, and then we'd go through Yarmouth, where we worked at a place called Tiffany's, which was right on the strip. Which was again, it was fantastic. Looking back at it now, and especially with the way wrestling is now, I mean, the scene is so vibrant and so big and pop, so different to what it was when I started out. But starting out, I felt like a superstar. This was amazing. And wrestled guys like Mike Waters, who was half of the UK Pitbulls, one of the loveliest guys you'll ever meet. Has set of balls on him that it's terrifying. They're about the size of a human. No, they just seeing him getting changed was quite terrifying. Had nightmares for weeks. Steve Quintain was another guy I worked with a lot, who was quite popular down around there. And yeah, that was me. That was my start. I was off to the races, but unfortunately, I was a bit too enthusiastic. Was doing more than I probably should have been. Was doing things that I wasn't really trained. I was taking bumps that I shouldn't be taking. Knackered my lower back. Developed what was essentially like a third ass cheek. Like at the so you know, I had the left one, the right one, and I had like a third one at the above them in the middle, just this huge swelling, which made bumping near impossible. I was trying to find some work while I was down there. Again, that was very difficult because casual jobs, you know, shops, bars, things like that, it's great, but I'm not available weekends. So that was proving difficult. Money ran out pretty quick because it wasn't well paid. I remember we'd done same the usual trip. We went and done Hemsby, so I worked two matches Hemsby, and then worked Tiffany's in the evening. And can't remember who I was on with, but I also had a squash match against Roy, Ricky's son, who was the Zebra Kid, was the gimmick he had at that time, and he had the most hideous mullet imaginable. And yeah, went out with my squash, and then went out and another match. So I had four matches that day in the same sweaty gear, starting to develop hives. It was quite grotesque. And got the van loaded up, and Ricky comes over and he puts down a pint of Stella in front of me. And I smoked at the time, and he puts down a Regal King size cigarette. Picks up a pint of Stella and, oh, you know the Carlsberg advert that uses the footage from that old black and white war movie, and the guy's just guzzling this ice cold pint. That was me. Start guzzling. Whoa, 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 son, you better slow down there. That's your wages for the day. Like, what? We didn't get much of a turnout. It was all friends and family, you see. So, I just thought I'd get you a point. So that was it. Four matches, a whole day of wrestling, two towns, and was paid the grand sum of a Regal King size cigarette and a pint of Stella, which I suppose in today's money would be pretty decent.
I know, I'm thinking that, yeah.
Drinks and cigarettes are pretty expensive, but back then, it wasn't a great payoff. But the experience was fantastic. But unfortunately, yeah, body was kind of scuppered. That was, as far as I thought, that was the end of wrestling for me. Tail between the legs, sort of thing. Came back up the road with some nice stories, but not a whole lot else. And yeah, that was me. We're wrestling for a couple of years until my next sort of opportunity came knocking. But yeah, that's a long-winded way of going about, but that's how I got. That was my start. That was my sophomore year kind of thing in wrestling. Yeah,
I've got quite a few things to unpack from just mentally making notes as you're going along there. When you're just right back to the start, we're talking about names. I think nowadays when you overthink wrestling, like Mr. Perfect being a weird name, when you go through like the roster, you think that's a normalish name. Then you get the Miz, you go, how have we let that slide for so long? The Miz go. But that's just one of those things. But see, Randy Savage and Shawn Michaels as your like first live main event. When you look back now, that's just like mind blowing. I think mine was Rated RKO against DX was mine, 2006. So
still a big, yeah,
pretty cool kind of thing. So it's when you go back and look at, I like speaking to people that are a little bit older than myself because they do have these kind of experiences of seeing like the golden era, golden generation, and into some new gen as well. And you go, oh my god, you got to see these guys live. It was just amazing. Right, so that's that point. Next one. When you're starting out, then you paid your money to go down to Norwich. Of course, not that much, if anything, up here. I'm guessing it was just like camps. If you were lucky, there were some things at holiday parks.
Because this was sort of before the internet had really taken off. Before it was really a. I'm sure the internet existed, but we didn't know anybody that had it. I'm pretty sure that would have been back in dial-up days and things. So, yeah, if it wasn't in the Yellow Pages, then you didn't know that it existed. And that's why there was something in me when I saw this guy in Scottish trunks. I'm thinking, this is a guy from... Because by that time, I knew that Roddy Piper wasn't really Scottish. I knew he was from Canada. So it was like, a guy from Scotland that's actually wrestling. This is how did he do it? And yeah, sadly, found out that he wasn't Scottish, but pointed me in the direction of Ricky, Paddy's training with WAW. There would have been other training schools and things. I'm pretty sure Hammerlock would have been on the go at the time. And yeah, there would have been other avenues to train, but actually how to find out about them, that was probably just at the sort of tail end of this, protecting the business kind of thing. I think if you didn't know somebody, you wouldn't be able to get into it, because it wasn't like training schools wouldn't have been advertising. I'm thinking off the top of my head now, because it was Power Slam magazine in the UK at that time, and I'm trying to think if I saw adverts running in that, like learn to be a pro wrestler or anything like that, and I can't remember seeing anything. I feel like if I had, I probably would have, you know, jumped at the chance, because Norwich wasn't the easiest of places to get to.
Okay.
It's probably the, other than sort of family holidays when I was a kid, certainly the furthest I travelled solo, getting on the train and heading away down. Which also I've got another story about one of the times I was going down to work a show. I'd got the train and there was a lot of changes, and one of the changes was at Newcastle, and the train got into Newcastle station at some stupid o'clock in the morning. Half past 1, 2 a.m. and the connecting train wasn't until 6:30, 7 a.m. and so I just assumed I would just have to sit in the train station. This was this was early on. Wait, no, this was late on. I can't remember. It was cold. I remember that much. Because the train station shut during the night. I'm sitting there all wrapped up. And I had a big Scotland flag with me. I had a great big saltire. You know, like the kind that are on flagpoles.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the proper big flags. This massive flag. I had ideas in my head of looking like a very small and skinny British bulldog with the flag as a cape. So I'd got that and I'd wrapped that around me and I'm sitting. The guy comes over, he says, you'll have to move on, mate. Station shuts. I'm waiting for a train. He's like, no, here you're not. So off I went and I found a little kebab shop. And I went and sat in the kebab shop and I've still got this Scotland flag. Just as all the pubs and clubs are kicking out in Newcastle and I'm draped in a Scotland flag. I just stuffed it up my t-shirt to hide it just to be on the safe side. I thought I'm not sitting here getting my head kicked in because I'm draped in a Scotland flag. But yeah, Norwich was not it wasn't an easy trip. Whereas again, now it's crazy how far guys will travel to go to shows internationally. You've got guys from Scotland flying all over the world working shows. But at that time, I thought traveling down to Norwich for a wrestling show was an epic journey. It's like son of a Lord of the Rings, yeah.
I mean, even saw it this year with folk going down to Cardiff to see Clash at the Castle. I'm just looking at it going, no. The furthest I went for a wrestling show was it would have been I drove there and back to Edinburgh. So I'm up in the northeast anyway. So there and back to Edinburgh for a show, which by a company I can't name. So it's and after that I was like, no, I'm I have to really plan out if I'm doing that again because I was just dead by the time I came back up the road. But no, folk do this. I'm seeing people on my Twitter timeline, just fans, just going weekly, just going, oh, we're just headed down to Liverpool for a show. Are you nuts? What?
Yeah.
It's just it shows you how easy it is to get to places now because of that. It's just
yeah, everything's just opened up so much more. Everywhere, so it's easier accessible and yeah, it's. But no, back then it felt like quite a journey. So I'm sure if I was aware of any kind of training or anything closer to home, I would have been jumping on that chance.
So you mentioned the Scotland flag then, the saltire. Right. So you said that you wanted to do a skinny British bulldog was what you had in your head initially. How much of that was like the nucleus for a bit of Ravishing Randy? Where was the starting point of Ravishing Randy Valentine?
Oh, geez. No, none at all. I didn't have a gimmick, so to speak. It was Paddy that was just like, right, you know, what's your name? He's like, right, you'll be Baz McGregor, because McGregor's a good Scottish name, because I didn't have a Scottish surname. McGregor, and that was it. That was my name. And so my gear consisted of, we'll go back to the pictures. One, I'm disappointed, it's all damaged and all kind of messed up. But there's another one.
Lovely.
In the Tandonellis, saltire elbow pads. I don't know.
If you can
probably see them.
Nice.
I coloured in with the marker pen. Yeah, that was my gear. And even now, I'm still there's a lot. I've got a little something in me that I like to try and make my own gear, not sewing and stitching because I'm god awful at that. But fabric painting and things like that, I've always liked to try and make my own stuff. But yeah, the Randy Valentine thing that came about. But a few years later, I'm thinking, well, I'll fast forward to, I think maybe about 2007, maybe.
Okay.
Again, just through sheer chance, my flatmate at the time, I was living in Montrose, and he showed me a story in the newspaper about wrestling in Forfar and how a new wrestling school was starting up in Forfar. Fantastic. The third ass cheeked, long gone. I've still got trouble with my back, still bothers me. But I was like, it's time to get back on. So I reached out and got in touch, and it was operated through Wild Promotions. It was run by Sean Harkin and his dad Joe Harkin, in partnership with Carol Conroy, who promoted Wild. And again, I don't want to speak ill of anybody, but again, this is, it just, it amazes me how good wrestling is, independent wrestling, and just about everywhere, most places, from bottom level right to the top. If you go to train, which we'll touch on later, I trained with Andy down at FPWA, and their setup is fantastic. This was in Scout Hall in Forfar, and it was just like a church hall, and they threw some mats down on the floor, and that was it. There was no ring, which at least Paddy WAW, you had the ring set up. There was no ring or anything. It was just mats, and it wasn't great, because you can teach the fundamentals on mats. You don't need a ring for that. You can't run on the ropes and things and getting to grips with moving around the ring. You need to be in the ring to really grasp that. But the basics you can kind of go through just on mats. You don't need to be in the ring. But it reaches a point, you need to be in the wrestling ring, otherwise you're learning kind of stops. So we're going through sort of things, and I don't know if the international, I don't know. I still feel a bit funny about talking about sort of,
there's like the insidey bits. I'm absolutely fine. Don't you tell me about the insidey bits. But
it's a basic sequence that pretty much everybody will have seen in a wrestling match at some point. I would say it's the first one that you learn, but it involves running the ropes, running a ring. So you couldn't run the ropes. So they just had us running imaginary ropes, which was just running along and stopping and turning back. And it wasn't great. It wasn't great. But again, there was some great guys were involved with that. Some good guys. It was one of the sessions was gimmick work, was just, because we got a gimmick. And I honestly don't know where it came from. I don't know if I'd just recently been watching something, if I'd been watching some Adrian Street, or I honestly don't know. But Vinny Vegas is much taller than me. Vinny Valentine was the original gimmick idea that I had in my head as this sort of Lothario ladies man. How I thought, again, 2007, how I thought there was going to be anybody in a wrestling crowd with a girlfriend with him. I don't know what. They're going to boo me. So I would come out and I would have my bunch of flowers, and I would hand the flowers to the women. And I don't know where it came from. I don't know how it popped in there, but in it went, and I came in and I did a lot of, I did a lot of prancing around, and I did a lot of, yeah. And that's just where it came from. And then by the time I worked, I can't remember if I worked my first match Wild as Vinny Valentine or if it was Randy Valentine. It just sort of naturally guessed, because it was, I liked it, but it just didn't quite feel like it was there. And it then sort of changed into something else, because I was a big fan of Greg Valentine. It's wrestling, because by this time I appreciated wrestling. Mm-hmm. So looking back at guys that I maybe looked over when I was younger, going back and looking, and yeah, Greg Valentine was not a whole lot of personality, but some solid work there from him. And liked him. Randy Savage, obviously, I was huge Randy Savage fan. Behind the Ultimate Warrior, I would say. In fact, WrestleMania 7, my I've never been so torn over a match as Warrior versus Savage in a retirement match. I was like, I don't want these guys to leave. I don't want to lose any of them. And Randy Valentine. It was had a little bit of a pun to it there that I'm a Randy Valentine kind of thing. And then the Ravishing bit, because I also was a big fan of Ravishing Rick Rude, and it just Ravishing Randy Valentine, it all just kind of came together, and there it was, and there it's always been, and that's who I am, that's who I've been for, like legally, for I don't know how long, 10, since before I was married, 10 years or something like that. So yeah, we're so invested in the gimmick that actually that is, so that's my name in my 9-to-5 and my job and in my everyday life. Everybody knows me as Randy. So what started off as maybe a somewhat cheesy wrestling gimmick became me. And now I've dropped the Ravishing because I feel I can't carry off Ravishing anymore. Yeah. my Ravishing days are behind me. I like retro. I like the ideas that I've got going forward for things to do with that. I think it fits. And I think I don't know if phonetically is that the right way to say it, but it goes together. Retro Randy Valentine, like Ravishing Randy Valentine, worked just as a title. Retro Randy Valentine, I feel, works quite well as well. But yeah, I honestly wish I could pinpoint exactly where it came from, but I think it was just a little something sparked in the head, and that was it. First gimmick that I came up with for myself, and it's stuck with it. It's the only one I've had.
It was like a nice amalgamation of everything. So Ravishing Randy Valentine. So this is we're jumping quite a lot of years on that, just because. Because that's just how we work it here on the podcast. So from that time then, so Ravishing Randy Valentine, he's a thing. He's the Lothario, as much as you can be, as much as you hope to be anyway. We'll go back to your first match then. So how did you feel about your actual first? I don't know where you want to count your first match, whether it's when you returned, whenever that was, or the camp matches, where do you kind of see yourself properly beginning your wrestling career?
I don't know. I kind of feel like for anybody out there that's familiar with or is a fan of Doctor Who, I feel like my sort of wrestling career, if you could call it that, has went through quite a few regenerations. And while each one sort of acknowledges that the previous one was there, they've all felt quite different, and they've all felt like their own thing. Like there was the holiday camps and things with WAW. That was not me. That was nothing really to do with me. There wasn't really any part of me in that. That was me going through the motions and kind of learning a few bits and pieces and getting some good experience. Wish it could have. I don't know where I would have been if that momentum could have continued. I don't know. I didn't have standout matches because I wasn't working on shows that had sort of standout. Well, I'm not saying that they didn't have standout matches, but my matches certainly weren't. I was just filling up a space in the crowd. I worked quite a lot. I worked a lot with Bruce Solomon, Bash, that I trained with. Worked quite a few matches with Roy Knight, which was great. And Roy was a phenomenal wrestler. And this was at a time when he wasn't focused on wrestling. He wanted to be. He played semi-professional football. And he wanted to be a footballer. but Ricky wanted him to be a wrestler. And the fact that he did both so well and just naturally was amazing. But I mean, the same now. I see things with Zach. Is it Zach Zodiac? Like Ricky's youngest son. I remember Zach being like 7 year old, 8 year old, like taking bumps or like off of the top rope in the ring and like just doing crazy things. He wrestled some shows as an 8 year old. He did a gimmick called Mini H. He dressed up as Triple H, and he came out and did, because he had the long blonde hair, and he came out and he did that, and he would wrestle his mum Soraya, who wrestled as a mummy, like head to toe, dressed in a mummy costume, which was, nobody realised that. The folks sitting there watching that didn't realise that he was wrestling his mummy. I just thought that was fantastic. I thought that was the best little sort of in-joke going on there. I had matches, and I don't remember them being necessarily stinking. I do remember a squash match that I had, the first squash match I had with Roy, because he was their main guy. Whenever the WAW had big shows, they would bring in guys like PM News and Texas Tiger Steel and these big super heavyweights from America, and we'd have them in working with like Dave Waters or Mike the Pitbull. So you'd have these gargantuans, you know, back to the Haystacks, Big Daddy. But as far as wrestling and putting on the wrestling match on the show that everybody should be talking about, it was Roy every time. And so he couldn't have him taking any kind of beat from little boy McGregor from Scotland. So squash matches. So this was the first time. And I got getting ready to go out, because again, there was no, again, not wanting to lift the curtain too much, but we didn't talk much before the match. We went out and we had a match. That was it. So all the world's got out. What did he say to me? Now, you know, it's a squash match, right? You know what to do in a squash match. Yeah. Didn't, but I didn't want to look stupid and be like, well, what am I meant to do? As far as I was aware, I was a jobber and I was going out and I was going to get beat. So I went out and we're doing a few bits and pieces. And I got a little shiner. I got a little bit of fence. I put up a little bit of a fight. Came back through. I was chuffed. I was over the moon because I felt like we'd had a good match. And Roy had a beautiful frog splash that he finished with at that time. Jesus, was it? When he landed on you, you knew he was landing on you. You know, like, everything in there. You felt everything. Well, most of the guys that you were in there, there was a couple of guys, and I've never really been a big fan of people that don't get as physical as they maybe should. But for the most part, 90% of those guys that I was in with, when you came out of that, you knew that you'd been in a fight. And I get through the back, and he comes out. What the F was that? What? Told you, it was an effing squash. That's what I did. A squash means you don't get four in. I'm like, oh, sorry. I thought I was going to get squashed for real here. I don't have any standout matches, favourite matches, things like that, because I don't really remember them through a lot of things. You know, this 20, 21, 22 years ago. Is it? Yeah. So memory's pretty hazy. But they were good, and it was good. It was enjoyable, and then that was that. And then next were the matches that I had were Wild, which were also fairly good. Again, nothing really stands. Well, no, actually, I'm going to say nothing stands out. Because I've never really felt myself as being a wrestler that stands out. I've never felt like I'm not having 5-star matches. I've never have had 5-star matches. I doubt very much I ever will have 5-star matches, unless everybody else on the show died in a bus crash on the way there, and it's just me out there wrestling myself. I'm not going to be the best wrestler on the card. But yeah, I was wrestling a match with Sean Harkin. And I worked in engineering. My 9 to 5 at that time was engineering, and I'd had a bit of a boo boo. I lost the ends of a couple of fingers in a machine. I got them put back on. Rushed up at Aberdeen Infirmary, stuck pins in. I was booked to wrestle, and I didn't want to miss the bookings. So I had like these plastic cover things on the ends of my fingers to protect the pins, but that's all they did. They were just plastic. And I'm out there, and I, at one point in the match, I get thrown out, put out the ring, and out I go, and I land, and my hand's just on the ground. And Joe Harkin, that was Sean's dad, was in Sean's corner. And they were good guys. They were getting the cheers. Joe comes over and he starts stomping.
Oh.
So they stamp on my hand. It's like, my fingers are held on my pins here, man. What are you doing? Trying to roll away from him, still looking like things have happened, but I'm trying to make sure that the ends of my fingers don't come back off. And he just wouldn't stop. He just, I think I pretty much rolled around the whole ring trying to get away from him, and he just kept coming at me, stomping at these hands. But yeah, I remember that. I remember that I had a really dreadful handicap tag match. It was me teaming with Alan Grogan, the natural Alan Grogan, and against, it might have been Carol Conroy, the governor, Carol Conroy. But it didn't click. And it was, I remember the bad things more than I remember the good things. And yeah, I don't think I get the bad things wrong, but a lot of the times I think I remember the good things and they maybe weren't as good as I remember them. But yeah, it was just having matches. There weren't any of these sort of like spectacular matches that stand out. I was enjoying them. I was having a lot of fun. And yeah, it was while I was working with Wild. Then say Regeneration 3 kicked in. The next phase kicked in. There was a Dundee promoter was at one of those shows, and come on, work for me. And pretty much everybody at the Wild show, Carol in particular, but Dave Madison, who passed away just recently, and on the Wild shows. I'll tell you who else I worked a few shows with. Never had a match with them. Because if I did, I'd be cashing in on. I did when I was younger. A very, very, very young Drew Galloway. I'm saying 16, 17 year old. Nothing like the Drew that we've got today. This was still tall because you don't grow all that extra, but build wise he was just a very young, fresh faced guy. Still had Charles, he had Charles Bonton with him at that time. And who else? There was Davey Richards, wrestled a lot of Wild shows as well. There were phenomenal names, phenomenal wrestlers. And I might have been in matches with some of them. I might have worked tag matches with them. I don't remember, unfortunately. But pretty much everybody was like, I wouldn't work there, because if you work there you'll find you won't get work anywhere else. And yeah, they were right. But I did get regular work and met a lot of fantastic people. Probably yourself included.
Thank you very much.
Through the Dundee promotion. But yeah, unfortunately, when that started, the phone stopped ringing from Wild, and that was the end of that. I did run into Carl at a show in Paisley. Back about 2009, thereabouts. And I got up with him, had a chat with him and stuff, which was it was nice. It was nice to catch up. Just there was no ill will and sort of things like that. But that was my time in Wild, which was not as the name suggests. It wasn't wild at all. It was actually very, very calm and very nice and just but just nice matches, good matches, good times.
We've got an episode. If anyone's interested, we do have an episode with Carl Conroy somewhere in the archives. Yeah, we've got an episode with him. So it's just an audio one only, but it is on YouTube. It's just got a big
Did he
thumbnail
spend the
there.
First 15 minutes of the episode taking his jacket off? Because that's how he would start every match.
Quite possible, but I didn't see any of it. It was one of those weird ones. Only what two times I've had to do just pure audio. I like having the video so I can actually, like, even though I'm looking right at the camera, I can't actually see you, but I see it like just out the corner of my eye, so I know you're there.
I'm there, I'm here. Yeah.
Yeah, so I like that. But yeah, it was just weird doing just pure audio for interviews. But but anyway, yeah, that promotion. So
yeah.
Well, yeah. So this is when I discovered Ravisher Randy Valentine. So it was 2012, August 20, I want to say 27th, August 27th, which weirdly enough, that was the due date for my son. That's a weird bit of timing. Dure Centre, Perth, drove down from Elgin that day. My mate was in the car. He went, "Oh, I'll drive down. I'll keep you company. I'm not going to fall asleep." Didn't even get out of Elgin, and he was asleep in the car. So
oh,
there was that.
That's a terrible co-pilot. That's
awful.
It's a thrashable offence right there. Oh
no! Dumped him out there. So I've went through like the majority of that journey. I don't need to do it on this podcast because it's not about me. But I did it on the K&K Wrestle Factory. So if anyone wants to hear that, it's on there. So
Stick
I went down.
The lights in. Yeah, get the lights in.
went down. Saw a match with Tatanka, of course. No, can't forget. Chavo Guerrero and Roddy Piper was there. That's the reason why I went. Teddy Biasi was the other one, and the main event was
Roddy Piper's. Well, still, there's anybody that will be right now going, "Oh no, I know he's away to say." He only can't now because RIP. Still owes me 30 quid. He owes me 30 quid from that show. I'm not going to go into why, but he owes me 30 quid from that show, and he made a lot of money at the merch table. Sold a lot of gimmicks, and I never saw my 30 quid. And that is a bone of contention between me and the Piper estate. Ever since then, he stiffed me at 30 quid at that show. But yeah, sorry, that's the point.
But so going into that show, I didn't know any. So I think I bumped into the person who was corresponding with me and ballsing up my ticket. I met them. And I think Martin Stallion was the only other person I actually saw before the show, because he was doing the he was like chaperoning Piper, I think it was, at the merch stand or the signing. So yeah, match shows on, awesome. Saw some people that I now see regularly, like Damien, and of course like Big Damo was on that show, I think. And but the main event was the steel cage match, and I've never seen a steel cage match live. I've seen many since, but this is the first one.
No, you hadn't seen a steel cage match live, and by the time you left there, you still hadn't seen a steel cage match live.
What do you mean the steel cage lumberjack match? That
oh,
because
yeah.
Took a while to put up this cage, which ended up being everyone on the show holding up the cage while you eight guys were in the match. Right, so the big moment is it's like my, this is, you're probably gonna like this reference, but everyone's gonna go it was like Jimmy Superfly Snuka, and I was Mick Foley in that moment. That was it. I was seeing, I know. So many things you could pick apart in that sentence.
You're comparing chicken shit to chicken salad right there. That's two very different. Ooh.
So you're up on the top of the cage, folk holding this thing. There was holes in it. Mm-hmm. Folk were rolling underneath the cage, which I think defeated mm-hmm. the purpose of the actual cage match. And you jumped off for an elbow drop. Now, in my mind's mm-hmm. eye, I remember it as being like this epic elbow drop that you landed it perfectly. I can't remember who it was. I don't know if we can mention who it was, but you landed it on someone, and it was the best thing I've ever seen. And that was it. I was going back to Scottish wrestling shows from then on in. From your angle perspective of things, how was the elbow drop for you?
The elbow drop was fine. The elbow drop was no problem at all, because in reality, it wasn't back then. I was a bit more limber than I am. So I always really liked, I liked my elbow drop. I loved my elbow drop. I used to get some really good height on my elbow drop. I would leap. That one, there were a lot of things in play. One, as you say, the cage wasn't really secured. It was more just held up. I feel like cage is being kind to it. It was more like just Harris fencing. It was like something you would fight around a building site rather than you'd fight around a wrestling ring. It didn't. There was about a foot clearance all the way around at the bottom, so it didn't touch the ring at any point. So it wasn't secure. What was securing it was the guys, all the lumberjacks, all holding it up. We were also under strict instructions. It was just me. When I got up there, under no circumstances was I to touch the light rigging, because I could bring the whole thing crashing down. So I got up there. I didn't really have it anywhere to support myself. So at best, all I did was I stood up and just dropped off of it. I couldn't leap. I was terrified to leap, because I thought, if I leap, this cage could just go in all different directions underneath me. So there was probably an extra 4 or 5 feet drop from the peak that I would get leaping from the top rope from my elbow drop and just sort of plummeting from the top of this cage from the elbow drop. So the elbow itself was fine. I mean, I would have loved to have actually been able to put a bit of a leap on it, been able to put a little bit more behind it, but there was just too many things that it was, yeah, there were too many technical concerns. When I got up to the top of that cage, I did actually just briefly touch the light rig, because you just kind of, you know, it's like when you see something that says wet paint, you have to stick a finger on it just to make sure that it's wet.
Yeah.
So I did give that, I just sort of gently touched the light rigging, and that light rigging moved. So it's like, right, okay, definitely not touching the light rigging, and definitely was not putting any extra pressure on this cage. That was a shambles. The match itself, by the time it took place, I think half the folk had left. It was never meant to be. I feel like it might have been first match back from the interval. Might have been first half main. It wasn't where it was meant to be on the card, but Piper was a pain in the ass. I mean, an absolute pain in the ass. Well, on the rest of soul and all the rest of it, but he was a bit of a chode that day. And he kind of threw a strop, and, you know, Piper's pit and all the rest of the things that he wanted to do, he wasn't following a cage match. So cage match got punted to the last part of the show. So everybody had seen, like you say, they'd seen Demo, they'd seen Chavo Guerrero, they'd seen Ted DiBiase, they'd seen Tatanka, they'd seen Roddy Piper, they'd seen, you know, they hadn't seen Mr. News, and you know, they hadn't seen the Meg Pals, they hadn't seen Ian Ambrose and Sam Ross, and they didn't care. You know, they weren't sitting around for half an hour at least while this cage got built. And so, yeah, a lot of people left. So, yeah, everything around that cage match was, and it is still to date, sadly, and I do say to date, my only cage match. I would like to have another one in a proper cage. It was. I wouldn't say that it's not fond memories. From a professional standpoint, there are no fond memories of that match. From a just absolute nonsense, did that really happen? Yeah, I mean, yeah, everything from the. I mean, we didn't know that the rest of the, like, at that time it was there was a lot of WrestleZone guys were working there. And so it was I remember doing stuff in the cage, and I looked over, and it's just like Bill Sterling, things just standing like this, holding the cage up, looking like, what's going on here? And the more I'm looking around, the more I'm going, this is every wrestler that's been out wrestling tonight. I've now just been sent out to hold this cage up. So, yeah, just ridiculous. And I thought a very funny story. And it's nice to hear that, you know, the people that did stick around for it enjoyed it. And, yeah, I think at one point, no, it was at the end, because the only way to win was by exiting the cage. It had a big, it wasn't like a traditional cage. The cage door was this massive door in the middle of one of the side panels, rather than looking like an actual door shape. It was like a third of the side just opened outward. And I can't remember who won. I feel like it might have been Ian Ambrose and Sam Ross that won, and it was as soon as they won, no, because there were times I would do things and I would get myself a little bit of bother because I would kind of shit on stuff. I would poo poo on stuff, and as soon as they went out the door and won and the bell rang, I just rolled out underneath the cage, making it glaringly obvious that we could have done that at any point and won the match, but. Oh yeah, that was some nonsense. That was some absolute nonsense. Wasn't my worst show for that promotion in Perth. That would be a few years earlier in a match against what was his name then? Was he Jay Phoenix?
Oh,
and then he was,
yeah.
Jay Wallace, Jim Wallace, Jim Brown. It's a Voldemort name around wrestling. He shall not be named. I had an absolute stinker. What am I mean? Stinker. It was. That was my first match back. Not making excuses, but that was my first match back after quite a while off. So was rusty as all hell, again, I don't like to talk about money, but I got paid in a bag of change that as well, because apparently there was no paper money left anywhere, and so I got a brown envelope full of, and I'm talking smashed here, there were coppers and everything in there. I sat and I counted out, made sure every last penny was in there. But yeah, I got paid in a bag of change, and then dropped it outside, and half of it rolled under my car, and So as far as I can now say that I have had at least one better match in Perth, but yeah, that cage match as much of a cluster as it was. It wasn't the worst match that I'd had in Perth. I'd had one much worse than that previously. And yeah, I think that's probably my worst match ever. And I've had some bad matches. I'm not ashamed to say that. That was my absolute worst ever. That was terrible.
I mean, the overarching thing is because of that moment, we're sitting here now and speaking about wrestling. Because yeah, it was the moment I came back, and of course, the end then went down, and who did the whole general manager thing, where I thought you hated me before I
I
turned
forgot
up.
about that. Yeah.
Yeah,
Oh.
I tweeted Gold Dust or something, saying that what should I wear for this general manager thing, and he said, I was like, it was like a pink, a tutu and pink boas, which of course was part of the pink
That was
boas
my
was
gimmick.
yeah,
My gimmick.
and I put it on my Facebook, and you started just going like pretty much laying into me, and I didn't know at the time that you were just being ravishing Randy Valentine. I think at the point my mum got involved as well. So
Oh no, I didn't say anything horrible to your mum, did I?
no, you're very respectful to my
Oh,
mum.
that's...
But I was like, going, she got it. She got the deal. I told her anyway. Oh, it's just that's his character. It's part of the thing. While I was sitting at home going, this guy fucking hates me. He's gonna bar me when I turn up in Dundee. And then I
Oh,
arrived, and
man.
you shook my hand and you spoke to me. And I was like, oh, okay, cool. I thought I was just gonna get hauled into the back of the hardware complex and battered.
No, it contrary to what was common belief, then I am actually was and still am. In fact, I'm a nicer person now than I was back then, and I think I was a pretty nice person back then too. Yeah, I forgot you were in the running for the GM thing, but yeah, I'm pretty sure just about anything at that time, if the opportunity for me to be a bit antagonistic, I would have taken it. So yeah, for anything that I said that you might have read and went, no, that's pretty horrible, I apologize. There was no genuine malice or anything behind it. But like I say, there have been times in the past. I don't think anymore. I'd like to think that I don't offend anybody anymore. But there were certainly times in the past that I would say things, saying it as not meaning it, but that doesn't mean that it's not still mean and it's not still nasty. I know that there have been times previous. I don't know if you remember. But Alan and I, we had a puppet for a while.
Yes. I didn't know if you wanted to speak about that, but yeah, I remember the puppet.
I made the puppet. I made the puppet. Yeah, he didn't like the puppet. He didn't appreciate it. He didn't
The puppet
find it
was
funny.
very complimentary, though. I thought you
I thought it was hilarious.
gave him definition and everything.
I thought the puppet was hilarious. Other people thought it was hilarious, but he didn't. And I feel like maybe in hindsight it's one of those things that should have maybe not asked permission as such, but maybe should have run it by. This is what we're thinking of doing. But yeah, I Alan and I both back then in our sort of videos and things we would do. We were both quite mischievous. We could both be quite mischievous, and there's still a decent amount of mischief in me, and I'm looking forward to unleashing some of that mischief going forward. But yeah, certainly won't be quite to the level that I have been. You've got to be careful on social media now as well. I feel like whatever I'd said to you back then and to other people, I feel like I probably had a go at fans and anything like that. If I was seeing comments on things, if there was an opportunity for me to jump in and say some rather poo-poo comments, knowing full well that then the next show I'd be getting booed out the building. That was the point. That was what I was there to do. But yeah, I don't think I think I would I'm certainly going to mind my social media a lot more. I'm not a bad guy. No, I'm not looking to antagonize. I'm not looking to antagonize fans. I'm not going to say that I probably won't antagonize a few wrestlers along the way, but
I mean,
that's their problem.
if he didn't like the puppet, I'm assuming he didn't like a group of us standing outside the Ardler complex with potatoes with googly eyes in them. I'm
No,
just no. No, okay. Didn't think so. I think I've still got that
all
photo
these
somewhere.
things to put on the map. We've got another. I think a decent amount of popularity that he had around that time, or notoriety he had around that time. That was,
Main
that
event
was,
against Viper, against
that was,
Dewdrop. He had that, and you know.
It was all thanks to me. On his own, I mean, he's a good enough wrestler as well. So there was that as well. But it was the puppet and the potatoes that did it. And I'm going to punch your puss. That
I get
was.
our kind of history in that promotion kind of it seems to kind of cross over quite a lot because of course then did the GM thing and then we had that thing on Facebook cool and then I had that picture with the potato I my one and only ring announcing job was you against him and it was like a lumberjack match and
So the lumberjack match. Okay,
that's the
right.
lumberjack
Yeah.
match the oh that was
Yeah.
the time where I turned up in a suit and someone who cannot be named, they're listed elsewhere, asked me if I was going to a funeral. And, you know,
Oh.
I should have set the tone for the day.
Yeah.
And of course, in weird way, in a weird way, you put on my rose tinted specs for going down there for with the elbow drop. You also broke them with your final act in that promotion at the same time with the we won't go into the details, but with the video post host one of their shows at the Bonner Hall, that I end up getting a lot of, but getting a lot of messages from a certain promoter about. So you know, you kind of you've been very intrinsic with my time down Dundee.
Right, I think I can't think what that. Oh, right, okay, yeah. I'm thinking, wait, what was that? Oh, yeah, okay. No, I'm following you now. Yeah, my shoot video. And again, that's I say I don't I don't I. If this was a what would, if this was a magazine article, if this was a newspaper article, I wouldn't waste the ink naming certain people. But we'd never deny that it had a lot of great times, and would say that I was there and in some ways was instrumental, in small ways, with an absolute peak of wrestling in Dundee. And yeah, met Alan through that, and met Kev, Kev Buddy Kev Williams. Yeah, met Damo through that, and then like Damo and I are still friends. Chatting with him just the other day, and it's yeah. When looking back, there are a lot of people in my life. If I hadn't been there and I hadn't struck up a friendship with Kev, then I wouldn't have known Kev's wife, and Kev's wife's best pal is now my wife. So there's massive, massive pluses personally to my time there. Professionally, also had a lot of fun and had a lot of good times and met a lot of people. But some people there and the way things are done and are done to this day are not how I completely disagree with how things were done then, how things are done now, and that's why I don't feel like I don't want to draw attention to them. But would never deny you know, the great times historically that there were there. You know, DDP on a Wednesday
of course.
in a community centre in a Dundee scheme. And that was Alan. That was a big, you know, Alan was a major part of that. Well, without Alan, that would never have happened. And I feel like, in some small way, and again, not blowing my own trumpet too much, but toot toot. I think the fun that Alan and I had, I think if that wasn't there, I don't know how long Alan would have stuck with it. So yeah, I kind of kept him around. Alan still being around, and that guys like Damo and Keith Piper and Scott Renwick, and yeah, a lot of people were involved in it. It was good. It was good, and it was some of the best of times. And that there's no change in that. But yeah, the fallout from that, and even myself, there are certain things like that video in question. I'm not particularly proud of. I think at the time it was venting, but now it's not something I would do. These days, it's not who I am. It's not the person that I am. But yeah, I forgot you were kind of involved in getting that out there.
Yeah,
that's right. Yeah, so just giving you no end of grief.
Oh God, I think I may still have some of the messages somewhere. I'd have to have a look for them, but I don't want to really relive it. So I'll leave it in the
yeah,
there. But
they
you mentioned that DDP show, which had my favorite finish from. I'm trying to think of ones that topped it, but my favorite finish was you was one of the Hurricanes, and I loved it. It was amazing because
nobody
I was like,
saw it coming.
You know what? I'll tell you the truth. Though. I was looking, going right. He's got to be somewhere, and my mind went, "Is he one of them? No, he's not." His name one of the Hurricanes, is he? And then you took the mask, the helmet off. I was like,
the helmet off.
Oh, you reeled me in. You reeled me in with it and got me. But oh, that was class. That was so yeah. I mean, like you're saying, there's good things happened, but you know,
I'm still very good friends with one of the Hurricanes, Chris. Hi, Chris. And his son Christian actually fell out with his dad because of that, because he was like, how could you not have known? You were standing right next to him. How could you not have known? And he like, yeah, we reeled a lot of people in with that one. Like I said, did some good work. Again, the matches with the tie, some really good. Those were pretty much my last competitive matches for almost 10 years. Thoroughly enjoyed them. Thought it was a nice little story. Had some good quality matches, nice finishes to them. Told good stories. Thoroughly enjoyed that side of things. Yeah, enjoyed. It was just the other stuff. It's like, I think everybody can relate. Everybody's had one of those places where you've worked that you don't necessarily like the place you work, and you don't like the boss, but your workmates kind of keep you going. Mm-hmm. And it was once everybody started to dwindle, then that was the sort of end of the party there. That was it. I'm lying under. And as far as I was aware, that was me. I was never gonna wrestle again. I did one more match. Well, actually, had three matches since then. First one shortly after, I was in the SWA Battle Zone down in Kilmarnock, which was an absolute disaster. Things weren't going to work out too well for me in that match. Once a guy called Adam was in, and so match is going on. I quite enjoyed it. Got a good cheer from the crowd. Got a good when went out, hit the corner. Come on, Kilmarnock, let's hear you. Some good old holiday camp stuff. Cheering, and it's like, ah, oh, this is fantastic. So I was thoroughly enjoying it. Was in there, had a few things going on with, I can't remember their names now. Doesn't matter. So no, it doesn't matter. But yeah, I've completely forgotten who they were. But I've had a few things going on, and I hear announcing Adam. Shit, here comes Adam. So I'm not going to be around much longer. Going to hit the ground. And I looked in the ring. I looked and went, yeah, I have no idea who that guy is. And it was the wrong Adam. There was another Adam. So I probably should have been involved in that match a little longer than I should. And by not being there, completely screwed up a lot of other things. So it didn't go too successfully. And that was it. My one and only, one and done show for SWA. I was the phone never rang. I was not invited back down. That was the end of that. After that, then it was sitting doing commentary and Discovery. I was quite happy with that. And every so often we get the itch. There is a tag team match that Alan will deny all existence of. There is no footage of. It never happened, didn't happen, doesn't exist. Because actually, yeah, see, no. I still say the Jay Phoenix match was the most stinking, god-awful crime against wrestling that I've ever been physically involved in. This tag match was close. God love them for the lack of trying. Spent a lot of it working with Shady Natras.
Mm-hmm.
Absolute pro the whole way through. Well looked after, but I hadn't wrestled. I hadn't done any. I was really badly out of shape. Quite a few of the guys after it were like, well, never watched a guy just get the absolute shit kicked out of him for 10 minutes, but seen it now, because that's all. I don't think I got vertical, and not for the lack of trying. You know, when I'm in there and Natras is pummel, and there's maybe been a few opportunities where I could have done something to try and come back. I couldn't get breathing at my arse. I was done. So I just lay there and got battered. 10 minutes. Tagged Alan in. Alan did a little something. I can't even remember how it wound up. I know we didn't win. And like I say, Alan will deny all this match. It never happened because it was so bad. Discovery was commentary, and which was fairly new to me. And I think going back to the first shows to where I am now, I think as a commentator, come on quite well. I think I do a fairly decent job of it. Thoroughly enjoy it. It's been absolutely fantastic. Continues. I'm saying been. I'm talking about it like past tense, like I've died or something. It still continues to be. In fact, got year 7 just round the corner. Past the corner. By the time this comes out, it'll have been last week.
It will have
been. At the time of recording, it's still to come. But yeah, thoroughly looking forward to getting to sit there and commentate on some outstanding matches.
So we could say some absolutely ridiculous. So can't believe you beat Joe Hendry. BT Gunn had to pull out, and you had to take the belt off him. That was just amazing.
Yeah, nobody saw that coming. I've got my gear in the boot.
We've got a wee bit of time left, so I'm going to go through a couple more questions on which actually
Sorry, yeah,
goes into
I'm
like
rambling on here.
it's absolutely fine. It's just that yeah, my time now is unfortunately very limited with this, and I'm so much enjoying this chat that I'll take the wrath from Kelly for it. So we got cheeky two-parter from Brent Carter. He's put
Fuck yeah, him, I saw that.
what have been some of your favorite matches to call a Discovery Wrestling?
Yeah, I've been thinking long because I saw that. I saw those questions. I've been giving them some thought, and I've been struggling to come up with an answer. Because I enjoy them all. To be honest, calling them is it's difficult because as a commentator, I find commentary is it's a tricky line to walk, because especially now in today's wrestling, there was a time where you had, you know, you had your play-by-play guy, you had your color guy, which kind of works, but I feel like it's they've blended together kind of thing, that your play-by-play guy needs to have some color and your color guy needs to have some play-by-play. And I feel Dan and I have got a good a good relationship, and we get into a good flow after a while. Often, I'm grateful for the VIP matches because I find the VIP matches help me find my feet, help us get that rhythm going on, so we're not talking over one another, and then we get into it. But I always find for me personally, for commentary, I love the matches that have got a story, because as much as commentary should be good wrestling commentary, you should be able to switch the video off, listen to the commentary, and still know what's going on. But that can often just fall into the category of just play by play, which I think you need a little bit more. I suck at play by play because I get the names of moves confused. So, there's so many moves now that I don't even know what the name of them is. I'm borderline Vince McMahon sitting there going, "Oh, look at that maneuver! Oh, wow, did you see that maneuver? What a maneuver!" I make sure I never use the word maneuver. But yeah, there's a lot of, well, that's an impressive move. Oh, he's hit him with some kind of slam. I don't know. They will have names. I don't know the names of every wrestling move out there. I'm not that well versed. So for a good flow of commentary, I like to have a good, solid, good guy, bad guy dynamic that Dan and I can play off of, with story in there, a bit of history in there, so you can fill in the blanks. So the guys in the ring are doing what they do, and in Discovery, every single one of them does it phenomenally. I can sit there and fill in the blanks and put a little bit of history to it, a little bit of background. So from that side of things, yeah, the more sort of character and the more story and the more history, maybe few things like that help me. That makes my job a lot easier. And if my job's easier, then I'm enjoying it. But the other big benefit to being on commentary is that I get to sit there and I not only get to watch the match, but I'm going to briefly, well, there's a bit of an issue I have with modern wrestling fans, and this might get me a little bit of guff, but anyway, that I don't know what it is. I don't know why, but I have sat there and I have watched absolutely phenomenal matches with a crowd that are sitting there quiet, and they will. They'll sometimes get involved in their little sing-alongs, and they'll start, you know, their dueling chants and things like that. That's nothing to do with the guys in the ring. That's the crowd. The crowd are sort of fans of themselves once that starts going on. The guys in the ring could stop wrestling, and I don't think they would notice a lot of the time because they're caught up in just chanting at one another and singing along with one another. But then there's other points in the match that they sit there just silent. And I don't know if that's awkwardness, shyness. I don't know what it is. But yeah, wrestling fans aren't as vocal now as they used to be, which is quite strange. As a commentator, while I'm on commentary, I have no choice. I have to be vocal. And by being vocal, it means that I am invested in these matches. And my enjoyment of these matches, I feel, goes through the roof because of that. Because I am so invested. Because there's a part of me I'm having to sort of sell this match. I'm having to, like, hype it up. But a lot of the time, I'm not having to put it on. I'm not having to fake this hype. The hype's real because I am into what's going on in that ring. And so my enjoyment, I feel like there's been a lot of matches in Discovery that I have enjoyed immensely that the fans maybe haven't quite appreciated or don't seem to have enjoyed as much. And you'll see it online afterwards. They'll rave about these matches and I'll think, I was there and nobody was making a sound. Nobody was cheering. Nobody was booing. Nobody was reacting. You were all sitting there quiet. It's weird. So, yeah, being on commentary means that I am invested. I have to invest myself into these matches to put across how important these things are. And I find my enjoyment is just through the roof. What I would say, possibly my favourite match of all time, and this is for maybe weird reasons, was a Ring of Honor championship match between Jay Lethal, who was the Ring of Honor champion at the time, and Joe Coffey. I can't remember if Joe was Y Division champion at the time. I don't think he was. But those two guys, the match that they put on and the story that they told, because there was no history, there was no storyline, there was no gaga, there wasn't any, like, it wasn't even good guys and bad guys. It was just phenomenal, fantastic wrestling and storytelling in the ring. By the end of it, I had to get somebody to come over. I can't remember who it was. Some medical person to come over and check on me. I thought I was going to have a heart attack or something. I was struggling to breathe. I was pissing with sweat. I was like, my heart was going, like, because it had me. I would say above probably anybody else, Joe Coffey has had my attention like that in Discovery Wrestling from the very first show. The first main event, first show ever, was Mike Mondo against Joe Coffey. And at one point, Mondo was up to the point that he had to be carried out of the ring and had to be taken to the back. And Joe's in the ring and he had this look on his face of frustration, as in, like, I was really wanting to beat this guy up. Also had a look on his face of concern that, shit, this is the first Discovery show, this is the main event, and it's all gone wrong. And had a look that said he in some way felt responsible. And Joe left the ring and was going through the back. And Mondo bursts through, fucking bothers him. I just yells out, this is bullshit. Because I was sucked in. I was reeled in. I was like you when I had the Hurricanes gear on. That had me. And that was the first Discovery show. That whole show was fantastic. But that main event and what Coffey did in there with Mondo was, yeah, phenomenal. And there's been so many since then. The big match is always obviously the Elite against Team Discovery. That was a fantastic thing to sit there and witness and commentate on. BT Gunn against Cody Rhodes. I mean, you look at the superstar level that Cody Rhodes has reached, and he was in there defending the Ring of Honor Championship against BT Gunn, who in my mind is probably he's the guy that I don't understand why he is saying he's only where he is maybe a bit of a disservice, because he's a main guy, but how he wasn't NXT UK or Ring of Honor, AEW, NWA, any of these, like, hasn't been over in Japan. How he hasn't been snapped up, because he is another phenomenal wrestler, tells a fantastic story in the ring. It's easy to commentate because there's no gaps, there's no filler. From bell to bell, I'm sucked in with what he's doing and I'm invested in it. And so, yeah, going back to the question, to pick a favourite match, I couldn't pick one favourite match. There's been so many, but a standout for me was Jay Lethal against Joe Coffey, because I was so drawn into that on commentary, as a commentator and as a fan. I actually thought I was done for. I thought that was me. I was so invested that my body had backed up.
So a second half of that then is, what would be some dream matches you'd like to commentate on? So who would you like to commentate on in Discovery? And names come to mind.
You know what? There are a few matches that come to mind. There are a few things that I think, oh, if that happens, I would love to be sitting there, front and center, watching it, commentating on it. But they are also matches that could very possibly happen. So I don't want to say them out loud, because anybody else listening to this could end up beating Discovery at the Punch and having them first. So so any naming names, putting together matches, things like that, I'm not going to say out loud, because there have been far too many instances where I feel like I've said this to Alan a few times, I feel like my messenger's hack, because we'll be discussing, you know what would be a good, this would be a good idea, and then we'll see it a couple of months later get announced somewhere, and we go, oh no, the VS2, they got there first. There's other times that we've had the first matches and other places have then taken them and built them like, look at this phenomenal match. It's like, yeah, we've done that twice. So I won't say out loud, because I feel like most of them are a possibility, very real possibility. Watch 2023, see what's happening. I look forward to maybe not necessarily matches, but there are a lot of guys that I'm looking forward to seeing in Discovery next year, to call, like, for to sit and commentate on, because I do. There are certain guys that the style of matches that they have, the character that they've got, the things that the personality that they've got. That's easy street on comedy. That's easy to sit there and hype them up. So yeah, guys like Rob Stowe is phenomenal. Hopefully we'll see him at some point next year. Judas Gray is another great guy that I love to see in Discovery. Find him very entertaining. And even a lot of the guys that are just sort of, I mean, it's that Dynamite, phenomenal. Aspen's been with Discovery for, I don't know how long, 7 years, 8 years. And he's going from strength to strength. He's another guy that I love to sit and do commentary on, because he tells good stories. So anything featuring guys like that, new guys that are just coming up, existing guys that are gaining momentum, I'm looking forward to commentating on their matches, you know, next year and going forward. So actual specific A versus B, no, I'm not saying, but yeah, there's a lot of guys. Brent himself is fantastic. I'm impressed any time I've seen Brent wrestle. So I would thoroughly enjoy sitting and commentating on one of his matches. I would love to see him. And Will Cruz, I want to see Will Cruz back. I want to see more of Will Cruz, because Will Cruz is yeah, it's loads. There's a lot. There's more. I couldn't just pick one. There's so many, and so many potential matches that, yeah, I'm just excited to see more wrestling.
We've And Darren's going to be absolutely livid that it's taken an hour before he's been mentioned. So that's for Darren, Darren T. Goss of the Goss Dynasty, international broadcast analyst himself.
Yeah.
So we've got a lot, like.
I didn't mean to mention him by name. I was going to try and ignore him.
I've got about 5 minutes. So we're going to just crank out some of these last few questions, and then we'll finish. Big fit. We haven't even spoken about your comeback. So we'll finish with a big retro Randy Valentine flourish. So we asked stupid questions on this. We've got two. What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
What was that?
What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
I feel like the sheep. I think, well, for one, once the cow's down, it's kind of game over. Two sheep, have they got enough to put the one cow down? Cows seem very passive. Cows are very dangerous. A group of cows, what they'll do is they will surround a predator and they'll continue to circle until they crush the predator in the middle. But we've only got one cow here. I feel like one cow on its own, pretty useless. Two sheep. Yeah, they maybe got a little bit of a plan going on. I'm putting my money on the sheep. Yeah, two
Excellent,
sheep.
excellent answer. That's my answer. It has been since I started this question. Well, I stole this question from Krieger. And the second question that we ask everyone is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Now, I somehow feel in the back of my head this isn't a real dinosaur. But when I was a kid, it was the Diplodocus. But I feel like
Good
there's
dinosaur.
something has happened. I seem to feel like I've read somewhere that the Diplodocus didn't actually exist. It was a mistake, and it was two different dinosaurs that they put together the skeletons of and thought they'd discovered, and it wasn't. So we'll go like any kind of brachiosaur, long neck, long tail, love those things. Yeah. But
Awesome.
Diplodocus, yeah. I had a stuffed Diplodocus when I was little, called Dippy. So yeah. Diplodocus, but it might not be a real dinosaur anymore. I'm not sure.
Counts. Right, okay. So we've got two about your return to the ring, and then we'll, like I said, big flourish. Craig Berry, who's his favorite training partner? Why is it him?
Oh. Yeah, no, absolutely. Shout out to, yeah, I haven't really touched on it, but yeah, big shout out to Craig, to Andy Wild, who I approached and said, look, I'm wanting to get back into things, which again was because of Stu, Johnny Lyons. I saw that crazy old get back in the ring. I thought, Stu's back in there. I might have a little go and asked permission of the wife who was sitting next to me at the time. I said, what do you think? She's like, if you can get in as good shape as he is, then you can do it. I haven't maybe come through on that promise just yet. Not quite where I want to be. But yeah, reached out to Andy and sorted out some one-on-one training. And Craig was there for sparring, to act as my tackling dummy. And he's as far as tackling dummies go, he's absolutely fine. Yeah.
So I think we're definitely setting up for a part two in the near future. We'll try and make some time in the new year. Once you've got a couple more matches back and
That's
under your belt,
yeah, we'll
we'll
get,
do.
yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Before we like I said, big flourish, big finish. Taylor Bryden's asked, what happened to the New York accent?
Who had a New York accent? I feel like at best it was described as being some sort of Canadian. Yeah, it's gone. It left because again, three generations, different gimmick, different person. Ravishing Randy Valentine, the wrestler, was not the same guy as Randy Valentine, the commentator. And so, yeah, that's I suppose an easy answer. The other one is, I wasn't going to sit for 2.5, 3 hours doing that voice the way through comment. I was wanting the commentary to be taken seriously. There was no way that was getting taken seriously with me doing that strange, effeminate female Mike Tyson voice that I did. Which, for anybody that's wondering what it was, where it came from, Mr. Slave from South Park. That's all it was. For anybody, if anybody's familiar with South Park, Mr. Slave was Jesus Christ. That was it. That's all that was. That was just me doing a Mr. Slave voice, which I felt fitted the Randy Valentine gimmick. But oh yeah, that voice is long gone. I'm not fired to see the back of it either, because I would get a numb tongue on the end because I had to keep doing the lift. It's probably offensive to people that have got lisps now as well.
Probably, yeah.
No, that's, I like that. I like that Taylor Bryden thought that it was a New York accent. I take it he's never met anybody from New York.
So that's it. I think that's part one, it seems to be. So part two we'll probably do in the new year. But before we go, if anyone needs to find out more about Retro Randy Valentine, what have you got to say to all those pencil neck geeks out there?
What have I got to say to all the pencil neck geeks? Okay, listen up, retro maniacs. Retro Randy Valentine is back in professional wrestling. And if you want to keep up to date with where I'm going to be and what I'm going to be doing, then you need to follow me on social media. It's for no other reason than the fact that I'm in my mid-40s and I don't really know how that stuff works. So you might get a little bit of a chuckle, but follow me on Twitter, and I can't remember my Twitter handle. And follow me on Instagram, and I can't remember that either. Don't follow me on Facebook, because that's my personal one, and that's just for friends and family, okay? But let's see you out there, Retro Maniacs. Let's get ready to fight. Let's get ready for the return of Retro Randy Valentine, because remember, I am coming, and I'm coming hard. Oh, I feel like a pop time.
Wonderful. Thank you very much for joining.
No bother at all, Billy. Thank you very much for having me along. Absolute pleasure. Anytime at all.